Bleach episode 19 was a 10 out of 10, and just here's why. Because in this review, it's going to be cut and dry. Usually I have notes for episodes for Bleach, but in this case, no. So we're just going to get into it. Let's go. This episode of Bleach was basically very straightforward with Aznot versus Rukia. Of course, with Ichigo thrown in there, Kang, Doobie, G9, and of course, at the end, Yachiru and Hisane. And as I said, usually I have notes for these episodes, but I felt like everything that you experienced within this episode was so straightforward that there was really nothing that I feel I can add onto this other than what's already been said in the live reaction or what overall consensus is online in general. Is the voice acting fantastic? Yes. Animation is why we watch anime, but in this case it was the voice acting that definitely carried this episode throughout, bundled up with OSTs and music and just overall just majestic and beautifulness of the plot. Animation kind of was, I'd argue, maybe the last thing on the list that really carried this episode. Sure, there were some great beautiful shots and some great cuts, but the artwork in and of itself, if this was a still framed episode, it would be fine to some degree. Now, I do just quickly want to say that Kuba on his club outside actually mentioned within this episode that he elaborated that he wanted to keep in the long speech from Aznot. The philosophy about fear and Aznot's whole personality, or his whole, you know, the big speech where, you know, there's a bunch of Rukia and she's naked and there's a bunch of fear like dripping down her. All of that is like the long speech that Kubo is talking about. And originally the script writer wanted to cut this short, but Kubo kind of said, no, I want to keep this in because that's the whole point with Aznot, right? It's a whole philosophy or set of mind, and it really does add to this idea of this guy is fearful. And this is where you'll see really the ending credits, of where obviously we have the credits over the anime and obviously the song as the Bankai is kicking off. And surprisingly, believe it or not, there are some people that dislike that concept. I for one loved it. I loved the music playing over Rukia's Bankai. I thought it looked beautiful. Of course, the complaint probably stems from having credits on a really impactful moment, but then again, there probably will be a re-uploaded version by Aniplex, or the Blu-ray and DVDs will have a clean version anyway. So I personally wouldn't worry too much about it. At some point you will have a clean version of it, so I don't think it's that much of a problem. But regardless of what, because of Kubo's decision to have that long speech in is why we went over the time limit, so to say, and the ending had to be integrated within the anime, which I thought was, again, the right decision. I felt everything about this episode is about Aznot, and really, yeah, of course, Rukia had her moment, but I feel like Aznot was really the big picture within this episode. Everything about his ideology, the idea about fear, about death, about being scared, was just really on point. But so again was Byakuya's point about fear as well, that fear isn't born within a vacuum, it's born within the insecurity of one's soul. So you have two different perspectives about fear, which really makes the whole concept very interesting. But fear itself, for me, is really hard. Obviously, you watch a horror movie and you get jump scares, like scary face, boom, like you get scared. It is very rare for me, for a cartoon, for an anime, for something that, you know, doesn't really inflict a realism, to actually make me physically cringe. Like, my body felt weird, and that's because of the voice acting alone in my ear was something that was so powerful that I didn't like the sound of it, but obviously for artistic reasons it was just so perfect. I know that there's some people that watch dub. I can't imagine the dub ever coming close to what this episode gave us. I'm always going to be open-minded to it, and I will check it out, because I feel like whoever does play that role really has a big high standard to fill the shoes of it. But in saying that, the artwork as well. As I said, animation was the last thing, because the artwork, it was so detailed, it was so spooky. It really went in depth with like the teeth, the scars on the face, the eyes being rolled back into the back of the head, the blood coming out of the eyes. Not to mention the artistry and the aesthetic of fear itself, as we talked about Rukia's kind of naked body scene with all the hands like crawling on the skin. Again, that skin crawly effect. Again, the flies, you know, flies aren't really seen as like healthy animals, and they're quite grotesque in their way. So seeing the actual flies, you know, Byakuya kind of stopped it before it went into his mouth, but Rukia kind of took a whole gulpful of flies, and they even landed on her eyeballs as well. And, you know, this goes to show just what fantastic imagery not only Kubo presented within his manga, but also what the anime is adding to that level of aesthetic as well. And then we could talk about the transformations as well, the skin being peeled off and the skin being restitched and his whole body. Again, it was just great. Like, what can I say other than that? It is scary. And they absolutely hit the nail on the head. I feel like I'm not talking about Rukia enough. I'm Rukia in a sense of, like, I know that when I do reviews, it's all linear and I like to go from start to finish, but there's just so many different things for me to talk about. Rukia, for a start, of course, she's the other main player within this episode. Seeing her progress fantastically as a Soul Reaper, as a character, really learning her own way. Of course, Rukia, she hasn't had too many great fights within the series, but this is definitely one of her shining moments within the series to date. So of course, nothing really new from the manga, dodging the first amount of spikes that, if you know, incite fear. But of course, she dodged them because her body hadn't been accustomed to the coldness that she was emitting. Obviously, she could grab it the second time because her body had adjusted, and as her body was getting colder and colder, she was able to start being more offensive. And this is where we kind of understand the full meaning of Shiroyuki, because this is the difference between Toshiro and Rukia. Rukia's sword makes her the possessor colder, while Toshiro's kind of makes the air colder, and that's the difference. But Rukia has never used Shiroyuki in its correct way. She's always used the sword as the cold part of the body, so to say. But what Shiroyuki's purpose is to be an extension of the body, not the tool of the body. So once she got the hang of that, of like, oh, I'm naturally supposed to be cold and my whole body is supposed to be the weapon itself, is when she could fully utilize it by making her body colder. -18, -37, -273.45, I don't fucking know. It goes to absolute zero, which is, if you don't know in scientific terms, is the coldest, I guess, theory out there in the world. You cannot get any colder than that. And then you go onto a Bankai, which of course is 10 times the strength of her Shikai. So technically she's going 10 times colder than absolute zero, which is, to our knowledge, impossible. So it is quite impressive. And of course, with a strong Bankai and using it for your first time as well, it's extremely dangerous. Someone like Rukia is so inexperienced. So to be able to not only take damage with her Shikai, taking damage with the Shikai, she almost fumbled with the Bankai, if not for Byakuya's prep talk, which was good. I felt like their two dynamics are absolutely fantastic in terms of character development. Byakuya has always been shut off from Rukia. Yeah, he took her in, but he never got emotionally attached. We've had this in the Soul Society. He's slowly been warming up as the series has gone by, and it's just really come full circle where that acknowledgement that Rukia has needed the entire series. We've all watched Rukia as a character. Her only insecurity was believing she wasn't powerful enough, and the only person that could elaborate that to her was the person that brought her in, and that was Byakuya. So the fact that when Byakuya said, oh, you're strong, I think I speak for everyone when I say we felt that. Like, that was some type of closure for all of us. Because, man, if my eyes didn't water when he said that, I'd be lying. And you know, there's instances like that where I do think to myself, maybe it was a good idea that Byakuya didn't die within the core one. Like, there's the argument of, like, yeah, he should have, because it would have been, like, the perfect death for him. But at the same time, for moments like this where you're like, this really accelerated Rukia's character. Yeah, did Byakuya come in and save her? Yeah, to some degree, sure. But Rukia is still inexperienced. You know, you need, this is why Byakuya says you need 10 years to really train your Bankai, to even use it to some degree, to be somewhat experienced. And this goes with all captains, and this goes with Toshiro too. Just because you learn Bankai doesn't mean you know how to use it. You need at least 10 years. So, you know, we have Rukia, which is, I don't know how you're going to be able to train Bankai for 10 years to be able to utilize it correctly. But damn it, if that cooldown and her fingers were about to snap off if it wasn't for Byakuya coming in. Of course, the OST is from Sagasu. The ending song was great. And then, of course, a new remix of one of the old original OSTs was just fantastic. It was beautiful, majestic. And again, of course, that transformation for Rukia, the transparency, just looking absolutely like glass, like ice, up until it gets to like the head, and then it looks a bit more solid, but even the hair is like transparent. Do I agree with the direction? Like, again, this is getting to the nitpicking parts now, right? But it's like, do I agree that the hair should have been wavy when it's supposed to be ice solid? I mean, I personally think it should, but I guess for aesthetics reasons, I think it did its magic. I mean, I'm just nitpicking for the sake of it, but it was just a thought in my head. But regardless of what, in the anime, it accelerated the manga. Like, it was better in the anime than in the manga. I'm sorry to all the fan artists out there, but this was the best that I've ever seen it. Like, BBS, like, this was just, like, the best that I've seen it. And they, like, I'm stunned. So, yeah, this episode killed it, instilling fear, instilling majesticness, instilling beauty, instilling ideology. The CG was great. I imagine that was Ufotable's part in it, if it wasn't the studio, the animator who came from Ufotable. And if not, then I'm silly. And Cindy as well, I can tell that she did a few Aznot shots. I hope she did a few Rukia too, but I did somewhat notice some of the Aznot shots. So yeah, Cindy, fantastic. The motion was great, and I'm so glad that they drew the Tartar for us. I don't know how to pronounce it, but I'm glad that that wasn't CG, and I'm glad the big monster thing with the skin coming down on the face, I'm glad that that wasn't CG as well. Like, everything, like, the only thing that was CG was the eyes that was, like, surrounding Rukia, and that was fine. And of course the flies as well. I think the flies are fantastic CG, but I'm so glad that this wasn't CG to the max, because I was expecting laziness, but in fact, just the artists, the drawing people, the people that drew most of Aznot, they went in hard. Like, they wasn't lazy in the slightest. Even when things was in motion, they did not be lazy. Every frame was taken with care, and I'm so impressed. Of course, at the end of the episode, we have Isane and Yachiru, and I felt like the thing that was great about that was, not only was it like a sneak peek about what we're going to get next episode, and a little bit of like cutting off, you know, and getting straight into the episode when that comes, but I do think the thing that really set this up the best was the music. The music for Gremy's appearance, or Gremy's fights coming up, is just, it was perfect to end off that episode. And of course, Ichigo at the very start of the episode, I know we're kind of going all over the place, Ichigo's is confident, saying, look, I don't know if you're losing, I don't know the situation, but whatever you do, hold off for as long as you can. And yeah, Ichigo is very self-aware that he might sound cocky, but he understands how strong he is as well. Breaking the sound barrier, somebody wanted me to mention that for some reason. Ichigo's been breaking the sound barrier for ages, right? He's literally doing flash step. He was, you know, come on, like, he's faster than light. So, I mean, it's not really impressive. I think the sound effect was cool, though. And yeah, it's really nice to see Ichigo finally at a level of, like, we're getting to learn more about him, even as a manga reader, seeing just more of him. And I'm so glad that they did the patterns on his kimono or turban, whatever you want to call it, because it looks gorgeous. I was really worried from seeing that first PV that they wouldn't add the patterns, but I'm so glad that they did. And of course, the CGI stairway to Soul Society was really nice as well. Of course, there's the argument of whether it resembles Snake Way. I guess any trip to any destination can be classified as Snake Way, I guess, but I think it's a bit of a stretch. I think people just want to make references to where they want to make them. So, but I think the whole aesthetic about it was fantastic. And of course, I think the edgy, well, I mean, the whole episode was edgy, but to see Kang Do and BG9 beheaded, oh man, like, anytime I see, look, I'm not gonna lie, when I see Uryu and Harshworld on screen, like, I know that they're badass. I know Uryu can be badass later on in the arc. I know Harshworld's quite the villain, right? I know that they're hims, right? But I'm not gonna lie, they're usually the weakest parts of the Thousand Year Blood War arc so far. But when I saw this scene happening, I'm like, okay, we're gonna get some dialogue between these two. But the way Jugram really came in and really made a statement, I was baffled. And they didn't really need to go that hard. They went extra edgy for no reason. I love the friction shot that Shengdu had on his neck from obviously hitting steel and iron, creating that friction heat. Lovely attention to detail. It's stuff like that that makes me bricked, man. I fucking love that shit, right? Because it shows that they care. They could have been so lazy, but I love that. That was so good. And then, of course, obviously, Shengdu got beheaded, and of course, so did BG9. And then we get the explanation that every time a Stone Ritter dies, or any Quincy in general dies, they get reabsorbed back into Yuha. Their skills, their abilities, and their knowledge go straight to Yuha. So Man doesn't even need to get involved in the war, because he learns everything about every Soul Reaper, every captain, everyone, just through absorbing people. And then he can obviously work around that. And it's important. So obviously there was a part that was silenced out by Jugram's voice. I mean, I somewhat guess what it is, but of course, I'm not going to spoil it for anyone that is watching anime only. So, again, fantastic episode. I think it was very straightforward, and I can't express enough that regardless of whatever we had in this episode, Esnot was the time to shine in this episode. So was Rukia. So was Byakuya. And to be honest with you, there would never be an objective review because everything was just fanboyism for me this episode. If you saw the live reaction, you saw the live reaction. I thought, there's nothing that needs to be said. It was gas. It was peak. 10 out of 10. Actually, like this, I've never seen an anime episode. Like truly, like all the anime that I've watched, all the media that I've watched, I don't think have ever done something like this before or executed it like this before. So that's my review on it. 10 out of 10 episode, fantastic. And it was amazing. Other than that, if you dislike it because of the ending song, get over it, because in the Blu-ray, it will be cleared up anyway. So who cares? So with that being said, I'm going to catch you motherfuckers later. You guys, of course, have this fun. David Hansen. As always, people, peace out.